Hallelujah. Well, this morning, you know, the Lord has put a word in my heart to share with you, and that's on the resurrection power. Amen. John 10:10 says, "The thief does not come except to steal, kill, and destroy. I have come that they may have life and that they may have it more abundantly." Amen. So Jesus has come so that you would have life. Everybody say life. John 3:16, "For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life." Amen? So we see here how Jesus has come so that we can have life. And so many of us, you know, we're going through life just existing. We need the resurrection power of Jesus at work in us. Amen? We need the fire of God in us. Amen? He has promised it and he will give it to us. Amen? Death no longer has power over you. And what do I mean by that? The fear of death cannot come in anymore. Death in your body cannot exist anymore. That means when death and destruction try and come in, it has no power and no right. Amen? And you as a believer of Christ need to recognize that you have to say no to the enemy, no to the thought, no to the body when it's not feeling good. Amen? You got to say, No, I am redeemed by the blood of Jesus. See, I was struggling in an area not so long ago where my legs were just, they were in pain, in constant pain. I would wake up and my legs would just be in constant pain. And I would just be like, oh, you know, I was complaining. Just like, oh, they hurt. You know, why do they hurt? And the Lord spoke to me and he says, "How long will you let it hurt?" And I was like, oh. I said, "Okay, no longer." And so I prayed over myself and I commanded strength to my legs. I commanded that all pain leave in the name of Jesus. And you know what? I haven't struggled with that pain anymore. Some of us are going through life and aches and pains and brokenness and issues of life. And God is telling you, how long will you allow that to come into your life? When are you going to say enough is enough? See, the thief comes to steal, kill, and destroy. What areas are you allowing the enemy to come in to steal, kill, and destroy? What have you allowed to come into your ear and you chose to believe that lie over the word of God? It's awfully quiet. Hallelujah. I'm sweating up here. Hallelujah. But Jesus has come to give you life. Amen. Life to your body, life to your dreams, life to your marriage, life to your relationships, life in your workplace. He has come to give you life. That means you have the resurrection life in you. In you. Go with me to John. I'm going to go through a lot of scriptures this morning, so if you can't keep up, just write them down. John 11. 25 says, "I am the resurrection and the life. He who believes in me, though he may die, he shall live. And whoever lives and believes in me shall never die." Do you believe this? Amen. See, the word resurrection means the act of causing something that had ended or been forgotten or lost to exist again, to be used again. God's not done with you yet. Amen? He's about to revive you this morning. The resurrection power that is in you is going to come alive. Amen? Hallelujah. Colossians 3, it says, "Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ to a new life, sharing in his resurrection from the dead, keep seeking the things that are above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God. Set your mind and keep focus habitually on the things above, the heavenly things, not on things that are on the earth, which have only temporal value." See, there's an if there. Therefore, if you have been raised with Christ. If you have been raised with Christ. Romans 6:4. Therefore, if you were buried with him through the baptism into death, that just as Christ was raised from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. If you were buried, then you shall rise again just as he is risen. Amen? See, there is a death to our flesh that dies. All sin, all corruption, all evil things that are in our life die in the name of Jesus when we are buried in baptism with him. But the thing is, we don't stay dead. We don't stay buried. The resurrection power of Jesus causes us to live again. But no longer do we live. We live in Christ. Amen. We have victory in this life now because we are in Christ. But you know, the common denominator, if, Romans 8:11, but if the spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will also give life to your mortal bodies through his spirit who dwells in you. Does the spirit of God live in you? Hallelujah. See, we are not dead, we're alive. The resurrection power, the power that raised Jesus from the grave, lives in us. It lives in us. When you begin to recognize that, you're not going to stay sitting down quietly. You won't deal with pain on your body. You won't deal with the situations going on around you. You'll begin to recognize that there is power and authority that is in your life, that you have power to command the situation to change. You know, some of you have, you stayed dead. You stayed buried. You never rose. God didn't come and die. Jesus didn't come and die on the cross so that we could stay dead and buried. He came to give us life, not to exist. Not to exist, to give us life. If, that's the question. If you were buried with Christ, if the Spirit of God lives in you, then you qualify. The Spirit of God is in you. Resurrection is in you. You don't have to settle for the way things are right now. See, we're waking up some giants this morning in you. The lions are coming out. Amen? The devil makes it his business to keep us in bondage. Yes, I'm going to go there. The enemy will come and tell you you're not worthy. He comes and puts shame, condemnation, guilt upon you when you realize that Jesus has taken all of that so that you can live in victory. Then you begin to rise up because you realize it's not what you've done, it's what he's done. See, it's not, we're trying to do things to please God in the flesh. When God just says, come closer to me. Come. There's transformation that is going to be happening in you and through you in my presence. You know, you might be struggling with sin right now, with addictions right now. You know, it might look like death is all around you. Hallelujah. But as soon as you recognize that the resurrection power is in you, things begin to change. You don't settle for the lies of the enemy. You begin to declare the blessings of God upon your life. See, it doesn't matter if a piece of paper came in. We have another piece of paper, amen? It doesn't matter what the reports are saying. We have another report. Amen. See, we have to take the word of God and apply it into our life. We cannot allow the enemy to come and tell us lies and believe the lies. If you are in Christ, you are a new creation in Christ Jesus. You know, so we've been existing. We got tired of believing God. We got tired of waiting for the miracle to happen. We got tired. And so along the way, we stopped living for God. We stopped acknowledging that we have the resurrection power in us. And we allowed, you know those mummies, how they wrap them? We've allowed the enemy to come and wrap us up, ready to bury us. We're bound. But just as, you know, hallelujah. He's so good. He's so good. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Just close your eyes right where you are and just begin to pray in the Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Horobasa karabashidi dioko. Hokorobasa karabasidi dioko. Hokorobasha karabasidi dioko. Thank you, Jesus, for your word. Thank you, Jesus. Horobasha karabasidi dioko. Hokorobasa karabashidi dioko. Robasidi dioko. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Those things that have had you bound, they're coming off in Jesus' name. They're coming off. God is calling you. God is calling you, amen? So the enemy comes and tries to put sin upon your life, but you need to recognize that sin was buried on the cross. It has no power over you. The only power it has is the one that you allow. There's no temptation that can come into your life that you can't say no to. That's right. That's right. That's right. When you realize that greater is He that is in you, you're able to say no to other things. Amen? Yes. See, sin causes you to hide from God. And we go back to the Garden of Eden in Genesis 2. It says, when God was giving them the order, it says, but from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, you shall not eat, for in the day that you eat from it, you shall surely die. God was talking about spiritual death that was about to happen, amen? And what happened? They ate of it. They disobeyed God, and sin entered into their life. And now what happened? They were hiding from God. When God came looking for them in the garden, the Word of God says that they hid from God. See, when we sin, we hide from God. It hasn't changed. The enemy's tactics have not changed. Their sin caused the glory of God to be removed from them. It hasn't changed. When we're dabbling in sin, when we're doing things that God has told us not to do, then what are we doing? We're disobeying God. We're hiding from God. And now we've gotten so far from God that we don't know how to come back. Because sin now dominates us. Because we've allowed it to dominate us. But then there was one who came. That sin and death no longer had power over us. Amen? The Bible says that the fruit of sin is death. You might be struggling in an area. You need to give it to God and realize you can say no. There is nothing that God, you know, hasn't done where you have victory over those things. Gosh, it's awfully quiet. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. See, a person who is dead cannot see. They cannot hear. They cannot speak. They cannot move because they are dead. Amen. You're wrapped up so tight in sin that there's nothing that you can do. And you know what? Sometimes it's not even sin. Sometimes it's worry. Sometimes it's anger. Sometimes it's unforgiveness. It's bitterness. It's rebellion. It's those hidden things that the world cannot see, but God knows. And we've decided to allow those things to wrap us up, to hold us back, where we can't do anything. But those things need to come off. God never intended you to live that way. He says, I have come to give you life and life more abundantly. Hallelujah. There's some things falling off this morning that need to fall off. Some worry, some stress, some anger. It has to go. It cannot stay. It's held you back. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. 1 John 5, verse 11, it says, and this is the testimony that God has given us eternal life, and this life is in his Son. He who has the Son has life. He who does not have the Son of God does not have life. If you don't have Jesus, you don't have life. It's the Word. If you have Jesus, then you have life. You have power. You have the resurrection power in you. Only by the resurrection power of Jesus do you pass from death to life. Without Jesus, you can't. You know, have you ever met someone who's living for themselves? It's all about them. It's all about their needs. It's all, you know, fear has them bound. The fear of not enough, the fear of not being successful, the fear of you know, you name it, they've got it. They're searching after the riches and the things of this world. And those things have them bound. But God is telling us, you set your eyes on things above. What I have for you is not down here, it's up here. If you need to begin to look up and begin to see what God has for you. See, there's dreams and things that God has spoken into your life, and maybe you haven't seen them come to pass yet. But it doesn't mean you give up on it. You still work toward it. You never know what God's going to do. You never know what's going to happen if you just show up. You know, sometimes we have to show up. You know, you've been waiting to get married and nothing's happened. Man, just show up. Seek God. Let God bring the right person into your life. You might be struggling in your marriage. Just seek God. Let God fix you first, and then he'll begin to fix all those areas in your life. Whatever it is, begin to seek God. The formula doesn't change. It stays the same. The Bible says, seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all those things that you have need of, God will take care of. Are you seeking God? Are you seeking God? See, I'm not here to play. Not here to play. I'm here to deliver a word. I'm here to give the word that God has given me for you. Why? Because it's blessed me. I was that person. You know, I would come to church and I would just come in and out, and you know, I was living for myself. I was raising my family. Everything was fine. You know, I had everything that I asked God for. God provided. He did everything. And I was okay. I was okay just existing. But then something happened. I began to hunger for God. I began to I want more. You know, I never said, God, use me, I want to pastor. I never said, God, I want to do it this way. I never said, God, anything. I never told him what I wanted him to do. I just need more of you. God, if you've touched that person, why can't you touch me the same? You know, I just begin to be hunger and thirst for God. And I'll never forget, we had a visiting pastor It's actually Pastor Rodney Howard Brown was here. And, you know, everybody was going to get prayed for. The church was, I mean, that's, you know, when we were all the way to the back. And, you know, there's so many people. And he was praying for everyone. Everyone was going down. I mean, just, you know, the power of God was just so evident and so manifest. And I wanted it. I wanted it so bad. And I remember I was standing right over there where that wall is. And I was just waiting for God to touch me. And, you know, I kept saying, like, God, I just want you to touch me. I just, you know, I need this. I want it so bad. And not because I had an agenda, but because I just wanted to experience God the way I've seen other people experience him. I wanted that. And so he went and he prayed for me. And, you know, I went down and it was good. It was good. But I felt like there was just still more. You know, have you ever felt that way? There's just more. You know, there's more. And so, you know, everybody had left the church and, you know, he was finishing up and my husband, you know, I love my husband. He says, are you good? I said, yeah, I'm good. He says, did you get prayed for? I said, yeah, I did. And so he says, do you want to get prayed for again? I was like, sure. You know, but I didn't think he was going to go and actually take me, drag me, literally, he dragged me back there. And I remember it was right outside Pastor Adeseli's office, and Pastor Ronnie just prayed for me. And I went down like I weighed a ton of bricks. I know I was overweight before, but, you know, I felt like I was glued, like fire just went through me. You know, it was like I was the person that they had to carry out of the church. Literally, and I'm not joking, I was the person they carried out because the glory and the power of God was so strong upon me. But it didn't happen the first time I got prayed for. It didn't happen the second. It didn't happen the third. Man, it happened when it happened. And since then, my life hasn't been the same. You know, there was such a revelation of God. It's like he's so alive. He's alive in me. Now, you know, it's like the veil was removed. Before it was good. I was coming to church and, you know, I was doing everything I was supposed to do. But I knew there was more. I knew it. I would see it. And see, this morning, this word is being preached and you might be saying, well, you know, I want that too. But it's the one who is hungry that receives. You know, why is it some people receive and some don't? It's not a matter because God chose them and not you. It's because they have a hungry heart. They're willing to go after God no matter the cost. They're willing to stay late, to be flat on their face, just crying out to God. It takes a sacrifice. It takes a hunger. It takes, you know, more than just a Sunday morning two-hour message. It takes a constant submersion in God. When you recognize that the fire of God, the resurrection power is in you, it changes you. If your life isn't being changed, it's because you haven't tapped into that power. It's in you. It's like you just need to be plugged in. Amen. We got a lot of outlets. We're going to plug you in right now. So, you know, my life was forever changed. You know, never did I think I'd be preaching the word of God here this morning. It was never my desire to do. It was just me falling in love with Jesus. It was me getting to know and have a relationship with the Holy Spirit. That's how I ended up here, I think. It was just following God. You know, but I remember, and I'm looking at Titi Minnie over there, because she was a great prayer warrior. She would minister the word to me. She spoke into my life. And we need people like that. We need to surround ourselves that when we fall, we don't hide from God. We go running back to God and say, Lord, I messed up. Forgive me, Lord. I changed my heart. Remove those things out of my life. We don't run away. We run too. And then we surround ourselves with people that can pray for us, not judge us, not bring condemnation upon us, but lift us up and say, you will make it. It was one moment. It's over. It's nailed to the cross. Now get up and begin to do what God has called you to do. Hallelujah. Go with me to John. Hallelujah. John chapter 11, verse 38. Here we see the story of when Jesus called Lazarus out of the grave, out of the tomb. Verse 38 says, "Then Jesus, again groaning in himself, came to the tomb. It was a cave, and a stone lay against it. And Jesus said," here's the first thing, "take away the stone." Stop hiding from God. Stop living in darkness. Let the light come in. Amen? And Martha, the sister of him who was dead, said to him, "Lord, by this time there is a stench, for he has been dead for 4 days." See, when God shows up, when Jesus shows up, you can't make excuses. You can't say, "Well, Lord, it's been 4 days, it's been 4 weeks, it's been 4 months. Lord, what can happen? What can you do? Don't you know that it's too late, Lord? There's nothing that can happen." You're so focused on what didn't happen that you don't realize when the power just shows up to bring life into that thing again. That's what happened with Martha. Jesus showed up. He had just told her, "I am the resurrection and the life." He had just told her. And yet when he shows up, she says, "You're too late. He's dead." What are we telling God he's too late on? He shows up and you're like, "It's too late. You can't do anything, Lord." Really? Come on. What did Jesus say? Verse 40. And Jesus said to her, "Did I not say to you that if you would only believe, you would see the glory of the Lord?" If you would only believe, you would see. Do you believe this morning? See, you have to believe. Verse 41, "Then he took away the stone from the place where the dead man was lying, and Jesus lifted up his eyes and said, 'Father, I thank you that you have heard me, and I know that you always hear me, but because of the people who are standing by, who needed faith, I said this, that they may believe that you sent me.' Now when he had said these things, he cried with a loud voice." What did he say? "Lazarus, come forth." And he who had died came out bound hand and foot with grave clothes, and his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, "Loose him and let him go." See, there's a couple of things that happened here. First, the stone had to be removed from the tomb. You have to come out of darkness. You have to allow the light of God to shine. It might not smell pretty. It might not look pretty. You might be all wrapped up, dead, thinking nothing's ever going to happen. But when the light of Jesus shines, guess what? Life shows up. And then Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth." He spoke those words. He spoke the resurrection power. He spoke to those dead things. And you know, the Bible says that he has given us all power and authority to speak to the mountain, to speak to those dead things. Are you speaking to them, or are you complaining about them? Hallelujah. It's hot in here, guys. Hallelujah. Are you speaking to it, or are you allowing it to speak to you? But it's been 4 years, it's been 4 months, it's been, you know, I don't care how many years, how many months, how many decades. When he shows up, he shows up. Amen? And so Jesus said, "Lazarus, come forth." And then he commanded. You know what happened? Lazarus sat up, but he was still bound. He was still wrapped in those grave clothes. Amen? See, when life comes, you might still be wrapped with some things. But then he commands those that are around him to go and loosen him. You are commanded to go loosen people. Amen? You are commanded to pull that string and just let it roll. Hallelujah. 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 Life. He's commanded life. He's commanded life. The resurrection power of God lives on the inside of you. Come on, what are you waiting for, church? What are you waiting for? We are the church of Jesus Christ. He has commanded us to go. He didn't say, go, just show up and sit down every Sunday. He said, go. He said, go. He said, go. And guess what? You're going and you're doing and you're doing everything that God has commanded you to do. See, the worst thing to do is to not do what God has called you to do. You're empty. Oh my gosh. When God has called you to do something, you know, there's times where there's times where I'm like, nobody needs prayer. Lord, you know, send some. And you know what? The minute I say that, it's like I get prayer, and I'm excited about it. Because I know that's what God called me to do, to lift others up, to encourage people, to pray over them. You know, and that fulfills me because I know I'm doing what God has called me to do. When you're not doing what God has called you to do, there is, you know, you're frustrated, you're empty, you're grouchy. Because you're not doing what God has called you to do. You know, there are things that you're sleeping on. There are things that you buried already because you thought they were dead. But God is calling you to call them out once again so that you can do what He's called you to do. You know, some of you, God has put in your spirit to write. Begin to write again. Begin to just let heaven pour into you so that you can give to others. You know, for some of you, it's writing songs. Come on, get in the presence of God so that He can pour into you and give to others. For others, you know, everybody has a different calling. But you know very well that when you're doing what God has called you to do, it's like it doesn't matter what's happening around you. You know that you're doing what God has called you. You know that He's making a way. You know you're seeking God first. But the thing is, we bury things. We put them in a tomb, put the rock, and said, you know what? There's no light. There's no life that can come in. Amen. We need to remove the stone and let light come in. We need to begin to do those things that God has put in our spirit to do. There's no greater satisfaction than serving God. You can chase the things of this world. You can go after those things. They'll never bring you satisfaction like God does. They'll never take you. You know, you get like on this high with Jesus that you just never come down. You never have a hangover. There's no side effects. There's only good effects. Amen. There's fruits that come out of your life. There's no drug that can do that. There's no alcohol that can satisfy that. It's only in His presence. It's only in His word. Amen. Hallelujah. So when He called Lazarus, Lazarus still had all these things in his life. He was still bound. And so we have to recognize that it's okay if we're still bound. God brings freedom. Amen. He brings life into your situation. We cannot stay sitting up. You know, some of us are just sitting up bound. Because we don't want to be exposed before God. We don't want God to deal with those issues in our life that need to be dealt with. And so we let the enemy keep us bound. We let the enemy hold us back, never doing, never fulfilling what God has called us to do. But those things need to come off. In order for you to live again, in order for the resurrection power to come in you, those things need to come off. You need to get before God, and if you need to repent, repent. Repent. Repent doesn't mean crying. It means changing your ways. Acknowledging, you know what, I've been living this way, but now it's time to change. Lord, I come before you. Give me the strength to make the right decisions. Give me the strength to say no. It's a change. It's not crying at the altar and going back home and living the same life. That's not repentance. Amen. I threw that one in for free. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. There's a scripture I want to share with you. I told you I had a lot of notes, but I'm finishing up now. Hallelujah. So how do we access the resurrection power? Go with me to Acts. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 1. Hallelujah. Acts chapter 1, verse 4. It says, "And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, 'You have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Ghost not many days from now.'" Verse 6, "Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, 'Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel?'" You know, it's so funny how Jesus is saying one thing and they come to Jesus asking another question. Like, what about this, Lord? When God is telling you, what I'm about to give you will take care of that. Amen? See, get our eyes off of our situation and put them back on him, on the power he's about to release. Amen? Verse 8 says, "But you shall receive" what? "Power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth." Hallelujah. See, we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. In order to do what God has called us to do, we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit. We can't do what we're doing without it. Amen? See, the baptism of the Holy Spirit comes upon you so that you can reach others. Go with me to 1 John. 1 John chapter 2. Verse 27, it says, "But the anointing which you have received from him abides in you, and you do not need that anyone teach you, but as the same anointing teaches you concerning all things and is true and is not a lie, and just as it has taught you, you will abide in him." See, that anointing is in you. The other one is upon you. One is for the work of the ministry, and the other one is for your personal life. The other one is for you to walk in victory all your days, so that no one comes to deceive you. No one comes to tell you that's not God. No one comes to tell you, you know what? God doesn't want it that way, because the Word of God says that you know the truth. He will show you the truth. They don't know. They might come at you one way, but they will have to flee seven ways. They might come attack your faith, but it's the Spirit of God in you that will bring you back to the truth. The anointing of God has to be upon you. It's the power. It is the resurrection power. The anointing of God, the Holy Spirit, is the one that we need in order to be alive, in order to live and do what God has called us to do. We can't do it without him. If the disciples needed him, if the early church needed him, how much more do we need the Holy Spirit? How much more do we need revelation of his word? How much more do we need the resurrection power? We need it. We can't do without it. Hallelujah. You know, as Team Uganda is going this week, what day? They leave on Thursday. They've tapped in to the baptism, the power, so that they can go and do the work of the ministry when they go. And you might say, well, I'm not in ministry. You need it to be a good husband or a good wife. You need it to be a good parent. You need it to be a good worker. You need it for every day of your life. You need the anointing of God upon you so that you can function, so you can call dead things back to life. Amen? So you can begin to declare the goodness of God everywhere that you go. It doesn't matter if you're in ministry. Look around you. Look next to you. That is your ministry. Now, really, look next to you. They're your ministry. Your children are your ministry. Your spouse is your ministry. You don't need a microphone. You don't need a pulpit. You're a ministry everywhere that you go. And so we need the anointing of God. We need the presence of God. We need the power of God upon our lives. Amen. The Word of God says to stir up the gift that's inside of you. Amen. You have a gift from God on the inside of you. Is it sleeping? Is it dead? Is it dormant? Because if it is, now is the time to stir it up again. Now is the time to rise up again. Amen. Go with me to and I'm going to finish here. Hallelujah. I know the Luby's line is getting long. Hallelujah. Isaiah 60, verse 1 and 2. I'm going to read out of the Amplified. It says, "Arise from spiritual depression to a new life. Shine, be radiant with the glory and the brilliance of the Lord, for your light has come, and the glory and brilliance of the Lord has risen upon you." Verse 2, "For in fact, darkness will cover the earth, and deep darkness will cover the people, but the Lord will rise upon you, and his glory and brilliance will be seen on you." Hallelujah. He's saying, arise, come out of your spiritual depression. Come out of that dead spirit. That spirit of death has to be rebuked off of your life. Amen? It cannot stay. God's not done with you. The world might be done with you, but God's not done with you. Amen? You will not allow death to come and destroy what God wants to do. Stand up on your feet. Hallelujah.